Greetings, saints. I greet you all in the name of Jesus. Thank you, DC Ayanda, for introducing me. Thank you, ma'am, for this time that you've given me to share the word of God with the people of God. I just want to share the word of God this morning during this time of fasting, of prayer and fasting. I'm sure you can all witness with me that you feel, you know, you feel alive, you feel in charge. You know, these 3 days, you feel that, you know, you are moving. And this is the time. I love what mom said when she said, we are feeding our spirits. It's time for you to feed. No one should say to you, eat, eat, but it's time for you to eat yourself. So these 3 days, you feel that I've fed my spirit and I'm somewhere. You know, you feel that I'm no longer where I was. And we thank God for that. And this is the right time to really eat the word and understand. So I thank God so much. And I appreciate also my husband who is here, Apostle Andrew. I thank God for his life as well. Amen. I want to share the word this morning with us. My title is Identity. Our identity. What is our identity? And we take our theme scripture from Psalm 82, verse 6. The Bible says, I have said that you are gods. All of you are the sons of the Most High God. I just want that part. I don't want to go to the bottom one yet, but this is our identity. The word of God is saying, I have said, it is God who was actually talking, I have said that you are gods. So this is our identity, and this is what I want us to know this morning. I'm just going to be very fast. I don't want people to end up sleeping when I'm talking, because I teach, I'm not so loud. So if I take too long, people end up sleeping. But I want us to understand who we are. The Bible again tells us, in First John, if I'm not mistaken, that as he is, so are we in this world. We just want to look at our identity so that we will know how to move in this world. Right now, we find that most Christians are lost. We don't know who we are in God. We don't even know, you know, we are like a group of people that is being ridiculed by the world. You know, we are so pathetic. When you tell people I'm a Christian, they look at you like, these people, these pathetic people, because we don't know who we are. When we read Isaiah chapter 53, let me just quickly read this one. Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah 53, verse 11, the Bible says, he shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. You know, we are, the Lord Jesus came to die for us, like in this season of Easter. We are here and Jesus came and he died. We are here to celebrate the death of our Lord Jesus. He came to die for us. But here the Bible is saying, he shall see of the travail of his soul and he shall be satisfied. It means that yes, Jesus came to die, but he travailed, but there is something that he is waiting to see so that he can be satisfied. He wants to see the results of the travailing of his soul. He came, he travailed, he died, he was, you know, he suffered all those things and he went back to heaven. But in the future, what he's waiting to see is what the results of the travailing of his soul. Right now, when we look at ourselves, you know, to think that Jesus would come, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, came to die for us. Is he really satisfied seeing how we are today? Is he satisfied with who we are, who we have become? When he looks at me, because the word tells me that he suffered, he was bruised, he suffered pain, so that I don't suffer pain. Is he satisfied when he looks at me? Am I not someone who is in pain? Am I not someone who is sick? Something that he suffered. The Bible is saying he shall see the result of the travailing of his soul and he shall be satisfied. This is what he's waiting for, because he did his part. Now he's waiting for us to do our part. It's no longer up to him. This is why he's waiting to see and be satisfied. So we need to know who we are, people of God, so that we can see how to be victorious in this world. Amen. The Bible says, I'm not going to read all the scriptures, but I will just say them. The Bible tells us, do you not know that you are the temple of God? The Spirit of God lives in you. I've started explaining now our identity. The Bible is telling us we are the temple of God. Our bodies are the temple of God. The Spirit of God lives inside of us. God himself is there in heaven, but his spirit is living in us. We know that when someone dies right now, the body is here, but the spirit is not there anymore. We say the person is not here anymore, but the body is right here, which means that the body is nothing. The body is not the person, but the spirit is the person, because we say the person is departed. So the real person is departed, and that is the spirit. Now, this is what I got as I was meditating on this. I wanted to understand, what is the Spirit of God? What does it mean to have the Spirit of God inside of me? Now, if it means that the Spirit of God is in me, then it means whatever makes God God is in me. Whatever makes the Almighty God is in me. His spirit is in me. If I have his spirit, then I have the real God in me. Just like we say, the spirit is gone, the person is gone. It means the real God is in me. That is the spirit of the Almighty God is in me. So now, if the spirit of God is living in me, it means God is inside of me. I'm even told in Colossians chapter 1, verse 26, that Christ Jesus is in you, you know, he's in us. It means that then when we read Colossians chapter 2, we are told again that Jesus Christ, in Jesus, dwells or lives God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They are in Jesus. Now when Jesus is in me, it means that all of them are in me. The Spirit of God is in me. But look at how defeated I am today. We are so much defeated, people of God, when God himself is living in us. We don't know who we are. We have lost our identity. When we go before God, we ask him, we cry, we say, Father, please do this for me. But when we read the word, we hear clearly that he paid the price. When he gave his spirit to us, it was finished. I believe this is why Jesus said it is finished. He gave us his spirit. And he said, you guys, I'm through with you. I paid the price. I've given you of my spirit. Now, be as I am. He set the example when he was here on earth with all the things that he did, with how he was living. He said, this is possible. Greater works than this shall you do, you know, if you believe. So now, what is it that is lacking in us? We have the Spirit of God in us. We have him in us. But we are living very, very pathetic. You know, I call them pathetic lives, the ones that we are living compared to being God's. When we look at our lives, we lack, we are sick, we are troubled. You know, we are so sad. When Christ is in us, it means that just like the word of God says in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, God says, my people perish because of lack of knowledge. There is nothing else that makes us to suffer, but we lack knowledge of who we are. But I want us to know this morning, people of God, that the Spirit of God lives in you. God himself lives inside of you. God Almighty, with all his power, with all his strength. When you read Amplified Version in Colossians chapter 1, verse 19, it tells us that it pleased the Father that all his fullness, everything that makes God to be God, it pleased him that all all of that dwells in Jesus. And then verse 27 says that, and that Christ with the fullness of the Godhead lives inside of you. What God is trying to do in his word is just to let us know who we are, the magnitude of what we have inside of us. Because there is nothing that God can do anymore, people of God. He has come down and he has died for us and he said, it is finished. He said, this is all that I have done and it is finished. There is nothing else that he can do for us. But we have to arise as people of God. We have to arise knowing who we are. When we know who we are, we conquer, we take territories. You know, I was reading the word and I was studying the Old Testament. Just studying people and how they were, the people of Israel, how they walked with God. And I saw that as they were walking, they did not have the Spirit of God in them. The Holy Spirit came in us only when Jesus came and he died for us and he went back to heaven. Then, back then, the Spirit of God would just come on people just for a season for them to accomplish things. So you see that with Samson, the Spirit of God would come on him and that power that was given to him by God would just be activated and he would lift gates and, you know, he would do things. You talk about Jephthah, you talk about all these people. The Spirit of God would just come and it made them do extraordinary things. The Holy Spirit made them do extraordinary things. They would run from one city to another, which was impossible with men, but they would run, they would conquer armies, you know. At times, just one person would kill 800 people, you know. This is the time when the Spirit only came upon them just for a season. So I was saying, but us now, the Spirit of God is living in us. What kind of life should we live? We are supposed to live a victorious life. We are not supposed to be molested by devils. We are not supposed to be oppressed by evil. But right now you find that we are so much oppressed. You say, as I was sleeping, you know, this demon came and oppressed me. You know, someone comes to sleep with me when I'm sleeping. I eat in the dream and I wake up and I'm having all sorts of pain, or I can't see, or you are diagnosed with a certain disease because of the attacks of the enemy. Yet the Spirit of God is in you. It means that there is a knowledge that we are lacking, people of God. But today I pray that God may help us as we are sharing the word. I pray that our spirits may arise, even as we were fasting, putting our bodies under subjection, making our spirits to be alive. We want our spirits to take over. We want our spirits to take charge. You know, I was the other day I was watching Superbook, you know, that cartoon whereby they animate the, you know, stories of the Bible. I was looking at Daniel. I was actually looking at the three Hebrew boys who refused to bow down to that statue, and they were thrown in the fire. You know, imagine, they were thrown in the fire and the furnace, you know, the furnace was too much. The Bible clearly says, even those who threw them in the fire, some of them were even burnt by the fire because of the, you know, the fierceness of the fire. It was too much. It was even heated 7 times before they were thrown in. But these guys were not burnt. The kings even said, I see one of them, I see 4 people. But one of them is like the gods. He didn't know God or anything, but he saw that this is God. This is us, people of God. This is the kind of life that we should live. Our bodies must not be touchable. The devil cannot touch our bodies. Fire is real. And you know, sometimes when you read the Bible, you think that some of these things are just bedtime stories. These are real life stories. These are things that happened. Daniel was thrown in the fire. Sorry, in the lion's den, and the lions could not eat him. But when others were thrown in, they were eaten before they even landed on the ground. Why? Because Daniel had the Spirit of God with him, you know, and we also have the Spirit of God. The very first thing that must be protected are our bodies, because the bodies are the temple. The body is the temple. But look at how our bodies are today. I want to join with the scripture that Mom gave us. I want us to take charge. because the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. This is where the Spirit of God lives inside, rather it lives inside. The Spirit lives inside of our bodies. So, Mom gave us Romans chapter 12. Verse 1 says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you offer your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. So this is the body that we are being told to offer. Then verse 2 now talks about that we should be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Then, you know, the Lord was telling me, what hinders the children of God today to be transformed? What hinders them to take over is this body, because the Spirit of God is living inside of us, but he's living inside of our bodies. Now, what we should do now is to allow the Spirit of God to take over this body. This is why we are being told, offer your bodies a living sacrifice. Let it be a sacrifice. It means that these bodies, we must sacrifice them in order for the Spirit of God to do what he wants with us. Right now, we are on a three-day fasting. It's not easy. When you're waking, you have to fast. You have to, you are not eating, you are not drinking, you are tired. The body wants to eat, but you are sacrificing that body. We offer this body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, so that the Spirit of God can take over. It is not this body that is to rule. It is the Spirit of God that must rule and reign so that we can be victorious. But you look at it today, the body has taken over. The body wants to eat. You feel, you know, with all these signs that they are saying and all this health. I'm not saying we should neglect our bodies, not at all, because this body is important. Because without this body, then there is no dwelling place for the Holy Spirit. But I want us to have a balance. There are some times when they tell you, don't miss breakfast. Breakfast is the most important meal of the day. Yes, as far true it is, we must also know that the Spirit wants to be fed as well. The Spirit has to eat. The Bible in John 6, verse 63 says that it is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh profits nothing. We must know that our life as Christians, as people of God, it comes from within. When your spirit is well fed, even this body will be affected. I will be healthy, 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 healthy. Even like, I don't know, a newborn baby, I don't know if the newborn baby is the healthiest, but maybe I'll be as healthy as a newborn baby because I'm feeding my spirit. The flesh has to be placed under. Now they are telling us you have to sleep at least 8 hours. But you can't be sleeping for 8 hours because you are blocking your spirit from taking charge. Because the spirit also wants fellowship with God. The spirit wants to hear from God as you'll be praying, as you'll be reading the word. And now you are told you have to sleep 8 hours or at least 8 hours a day, you know, by science. But this is why the Bible is saying, bring your bodies, offer your bodies a living sacrifice. I can say today, I'm not going to sleep. Let me pray. Let me feed my spirit. Let me pray and read the word. Maybe I'll have an all-night prayer by myself every Friday, because maybe Saturday I'm not going to work. Then I'll spend the day resting. As we do that, we are making the spirit to take charge of this body. But now if this body detects or tells us what to do, this is when it will decide that today I want to be sick, and there is nothing that you can do to it, and there is nothing that you can do about it. And it will make you to sleep for days and days and days. You want to go to work, you want to eat, you can't, you want to sleep, you can't sleep. But the spirit has to take charge of this body. Now, when the spirit takes charge, this is where you will be untouchable. This is whereby we are talking now about being gods. Our scripture says, I have said that you are gods. This is the place that we want to get to. We want to get to a place of being gods, just like he is in heaven. so are we here on earth. We are supposed to rule, we are supposed to reign, but it is not this body that reigns, it's the spirit that reigns. I'm sure as we were praying, you could feel that today our prayers are different. Our worship is different. You feel so charged up because the spirit is charged up because the flesh was placed under. When we read the word, it tells us that the flesh and the spirit are contrary one to another. They are in constant battle until we die. They will be fighting just for dominion, just to have charge. The body wants to be in charge of the spirit. The spirit wants to be in charge of the body. They are fighting, and that fight will not end until Jesus comes. Until you breathe your last, you will have to fight this fight. You know, I was sharing with my husband in the morning. He was telling me he slept around 4. He was in prayer. I told him I slept around 2. It's not easy sometimes because you wake up again early in the morning to pray and to read the word of God. But the body wants to sleep. That's what the spirit wants. Sometimes when we share the word, you feel that your spirit is saying, yes, yes, that's what I want. You feel like to jump up and down, you know, and you are feeling that this is my message. This is me, you know. Sorry, that God in you is jumping it, that God in you is looking for, you know, for freedom, to be freed. But this body can suppress that God in you, and you can even die having suffered yet with the living God living inside of you. The living God, the Almighty God who created the heavens and the earth, is the one who lives in you, people of God. He's the one who lives in us. We are supposed to rule. We are supposed to reign. Look at the things that were done in the word of God by the people who were called by God. Some were prophets. Some were just ordinary people who were called by God. They lived incredible lives here on earth. When you read books like God's Generals, you see that people did amazing things here on earth until some of them had churches. They performed serious miracles. But I don't want to concentrate on pastors today, because sometimes we think that these things are for pastors. But these things are for us, children of God, every single one of us. The Spirit of God is inside of us. We are supposed, first of all, to find freedom in our lives, in our own bodies, because this body is the temple of God. So no one should be sick. No one should suffer pain. No one should suffer lack, because you are lacking. It is you that is lacking. It mustn't even happen like that, because all of us in our homes, in our houses, we make sure that where we are living is smart, is beautiful. If we can afford, you know, some spray, some fresheners and what, we do that so that the place that we live in is good. The same with the Spirit of God. He first takes care of this body because this is his temple. So may God help us today to take charge of our lives. We want the Spirit of God to take charge of our lives, of our, you know, of our being, starting from your body, and then you go to your workplace, your business, your children, your marriage, all those things, because he lives in you and he's concerned about what concerns you. But we have to make a decision. There is no way that you can rule or that you can take charge of another situation before you take charge of your own body. This is why the Bible is saying that we must bring our bodies a living sacrifice. So I want you people of God to say, I allow you, Holy Spirit, to take charge of my life. I want you to take charge because I'm a God. It is me who is a God. This is why the Spirit of God has been placed inside of me, so that I can rule and reign in this world. So, Spirit of God, I want you to be in charge. Now, like the Bible says, that the spirit and the flesh fight, they are in battle, they are contrary one to another. It means that whatever the spirit wants, the body doesn't want. That one is a known fact. There is no way that the body and the flesh are going to agree one day. But when you feel like I want to pray, you just have to force your body to stay. Like last night, I was really feeling tired, but I just stood up. I started walking up and down praying, because I knew that if I just sit down, I'm going to sleep. So I stood up. I started praying up and down, up and down, up and down. Praying, because the spirit wants to pray. The spirit wants to commune with the Father. I want to get an instruction of what to do. What is it that you want to do? What me to do? What do you want to do with me in this day? You know, what is your thought, oh God, for my children? What's your thought on my, you know, my family or whatever? What is it that you want, Lord? So the spirit is the one that communes with the Father. So may God help us that we take charge of this flesh. Let us not let this flesh rule us, people of God. If the flesh rules us, even when it comes to the day of dying, even if you still want to live, the flesh will tell you, I know it is over. And there is no way the spirit can live inside a body that doesn't function anymore. The spirit will just depart. But let the spirit take charge. Even living long, you will live long, because it is the spirit that gives life. The flesh profits nothing. So now for our minds to be renewed, for our lives to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, it means that we have to spend so much time with God. We have to spend so much time in the presence of God. But we cannot say we stop working, we stop other things so that we concentrate on praying. We have to do what we have to do. We have to go to work and all that. But when we come back home, we need to spend time with God. Wherever we are, we need to spend time with God. Now, you'll be tired. But the body will be tired, but the spirit won't be tired. So this is whereby we need to put that sacrifice, bring our bodies a sacrifice. We spend time with God. When we do that, I'm telling you, this is the life that I live. I don't talk about what I see next door. I talk about how I live. I'm telling you, it's rewarding for me to be where I am today. I'm telling you, this is just the secret for us to be in the UK with my family. This is the secret. You know, my husband and I, this is the life that we live. We live that life of sacrificing the body. I was talking to Mom V when she came home, and I was telling her, you know, I'm fasting. I don't even, you know, I cannot find myself eating every single day, honestly. I cannot find myself eating breakfast, lunch, that I don't do. But I fast. Not that I'm praying for anything. I'm fasting so that my body can be under and my spirit can be in charge. Whenever I do that, I'll be walking, declaring, feeling that my spirit is in charge. We are gods. We are supposed to be in charge. But most of the times you feel being oppressed, this is whereby you go to God and you're just crying, Lord, help me. And God says, but I've given you of my spirit. That is all the help that I can give you. He cannot come to die for us again. He did that and it was done. Now it's up to us to take charge. So may God help us to put this body under subjection. When we put it under subjection, we spend time with God, so much time, such that our minds will be able to grasp the truth, of which the truth is the word of God. Sometimes when you are full, you know, you try to read the word, you sleep. You want to know who you are. You want to know what the word of God says about you. You sleep. Because the body is full. But for our minds to get hold of the truth, we need to bring the mind under subjection. We need to put the body under subjection day or night. If you see that tonight I'm tired, take your Bible, read it, walking up and down. This is sacrificing, because the body wants to sleep. But you take your Bible, because you know that the moment I look at those pages, sitting down, I will go. Stand up, read. Walking up and down, maybe reading it aloud. As you are doing that, your mind is being fed by the word of God. You are knowing who you are. From there, transformation will come. I've seen the tricks of the enemy these days. His tricks is to keep people from praying. But you find that right now, at 12 midnight, I can take my phone and I can go on Facebook and I start watching videos. And how you know how it does. After watching a video, another one comes, you know, automatically. And it will be video after video. And you can spend 3-4 hours doing that without even, you know, without even feeling anything. TikTok, you know, up to today, to be honest, I've never been on TikTok. I don't even know how it operates. I'm not even interested, but I hear that TikTok is something, you know, something that they are talking about. It's something that is trending. Oh, yeah, trending on TikTok. So maybe it does the same, that from one video to another. And you can go on, and that is exactly what's filling our minds. Our minds are filled with what is happening in this world. We know very well what's happening in the world, much more than we know who we are in God. We hear, you know, children, you know, this LB, what, you know, witchcraft on children, there is this, you know, there are gay pastors and what. But for me to ask you, who are you? You don't know, because you are not spending time with God to know who you are. The word of God says that as we behold, as in a mirror, the image of God, we are transformed into, rather it says, as we behold, as in a mirror, the glory of God, we are transformed into the same image. So the Bible is saying, as we look, yeah, another version says, as we look, as in a mirror, you are like looking in a mirror, the glory of God. As you look, keep on looking at the glory of God, you are also transformed into the same image, because you are looking and looking and looking. Have you ever noticed that when you spend time with someone a lot, let's say friends, if you spend time with someone like years and years, and you are friends, you talk, you meet, and oh, you end up looking alike. So this is what the word of God is saying, that as we look, as in a mirror, the glory of God, we are transformed into the same image. But today, I'm telling you, the times that we spend, I was talking to my children the other day, you know, they complain, these people, oh, guys, come, let's pray. So now they are on holiday. I was telling them, we pray after every 3 hours. They say that we read the word for 15 minutes, or we pray, or we share something, just to be in the presence of God every 3 hours. So they're like, but I was saying to them, you guys, if you ever notice the time that you spend on your phones, you spend so much time. And we are told to give tithe to God, 10%. We are told to give 10% even of our time. We have 24 hours in a day. 2 hours, 40 minutes belongs to God. We should make sure that. So I was telling them, 2 hours, 40 minutes belongs to God. You even spend 2 hours, 40 minutes with God, you guys. So you find that it's so difficult today. It's so difficult, yes. And that's what happened with the disciples. They spent time, 3 years with Jesus. And look at them. Look today, the whole world is filled with the, you know, with God, with the knowledge of God. The Christians are all over, but it started with only 12 people, the disciples of Jesus. So may God help us to spend time with him. I think my time is almost up. Let's spend time with God. As we do that, we will be transformed into the same image. You know, yesterday my brother came over and he was telling me, so, you know, there's this issue that is trending with Al Jazeera about one man of God. They're saying, so, have you watched it? What do you think? I said, I don't watch such things. I don't have time. Honestly, I don't have time for such things. He is a man of God. He is God's servant. Why judge another man's servant? I mean, God, let him finish with God. I don't have time to do that, to watch, and then I'll end up judging. You know, God is so great. Imagine it with Moses. The earth actually opened up and it swallowed, you know, those guys, those who had, you know, we had done all those things. They had swallowed them up. God is so great. He has not changed. If he's not pleased with someone, let him judge and let them finish. Instead of me spending hours and hours on that, let me spend hours and hours seeking God, knowing my identity. If it is wealth that I need, then God will also give. He will give me wealth. Amen. He will give me wealth. I will know that he died, that I may live. He became poor so that I may be rich. So I will know that. And I will say, Lord, I'm not going to be poor. Amen. I'm not going to be poor. I'm not going to be poor. I'm not going to be poor because Jesus became poor. So as I spend time with God, I will refuse that. My spirit will refuse poverty. My spirit will refuse sickness. My spirit will refuse diseases. My spirit will refuse to be oppressed by the devils, knowing that Jesus, what did he do? He finished it all at the cross. We are told in Colossians chapter 2, verse 14, that he disarmed principalities and powers. He made a public spectacle of them. He defeated them openly, because after he died, we heard that he went to hell and he took the keys from the devil and he won the victory for us. He did it publicly in the spirit. This happened in the spirit. He took the keys from the devil, because the devil is the one with the keys of life and death. He was the prince of this world. But Jesus took the keys and he said to us, behold, I give you the power. Now the power belongs to us. The devil is now under our feet, but we can never know that unless or until we spend enough time with God. So may God help us to shut all these things. I was telling my children, what do you think, you guys? What do you learn on TikTok, on Snapchat, on Facebook? After watching, you know, I let them watch that day. They said, so what did you learn? Nothing. What did you learn? Nothing. So why spend so much time there where you are learning nothing? Why not learn something? So let's learn who we are in the Word of God, people of God. We are gods. We are supposed to rule and reign. You know, we are supposed to be, you know, those things that happened with Enoch, with, you know, all those people in the Bible, that they would just be translated into another town. They would just be, you know, they would just receive money, just like Jesus did when he needed money for tax. They just said, Peter, go and take the take the first fish and get money, you know. That is the kind of life that we must live as people of God. That is us, because we have the Spirit of God in us. Jesus was given the Spirit without measure, and he gave us of that Spirit without measure. But the difference is that, are we going to be able to spend time with him? Are we able to do that? When we do that, we will know we are. We will, transformation will come. Our minds will be filled with who we are. Right now, our minds are filled with all sorts of things. You dream everything because of what we spend our time doing, what we spend our time watching, what we spend our time reading. That is what is filling our minds. But transformation comes with the renewing of the mind. The mind can only be renewed by the Word of God. So if we don't spend time, or we read the Word today, one verse today, tomorrow one verse, next week one verse, it will not work. There is no transformation that will come. But may God help us. We can even start by saying, I'll read, like me, how I started. I'll read the Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. I start again, Matthew, Mark, Luke, as many verses as possible per day, because I knew that if I read about Jesus, I will know who I am. I will know the kind of life that I must live on earth, because Jesus came as a man and he lived here on earth victoriously. So that's what I want to do. So as I keep on reading that, I'll end up like him, because I'm beholding, I'm looking as in a mirror, and with time I'll be transformed into the same image, but the transformation will come from my mind. So now let's remove all those things. Let's remove all unnecessary things. You know, it's not necessary. We have Netflix today. You watch series and series and series. About a relative of mine who watched, I don't remember the series, she told us, she watched it one night and she finished the entire series, the entire movie. wished, I don't know, a couple of seasons. She watched all of them one night. She couldn't stop, you know, she was there for hours, the whole night. But what have you learned? What have you gotten in that? Why not say, I'm going to spend time reading the word the whole night. I'm going to read the word of God. I'm telling you, tomorrow morning you'll be a different person. So may God help us, people of God, as I finish this morning. May God help us. Transformation of being gods. We are gods. The spirit of the living God lives inside of us. We are gods. We are supposed to rule. We are supposed to reign as he is in heaven. So are we here on earth, people of God. We are supposed to rule. We are supposed to reign here on earth. We are supposed to be feared by governments. We are supposed to be feared by people. They are supposed to say, if there is any problems, let Christians come together and pray for us. You know, but right now they'll say Christians are far away from us. That is not how it's supposed to be. When Jesus shall come, he shall be pleased when he shall see of the travailing of his soul. He must be pleased with us even today when he watches us. He must say, yes, this is exactly what I died for. So may God help us to overcome this flesh, to overcome this body. May God help us, people of God. In Jesus' name, thank you so much for the opportunity, ma'am, to share the word of God as we finish even our fasting. If you feel that you want to continue fasting and feeding your spirit. After ma'am spoke, I even declared that this month is a month of feeding the spirit. Let it be a month of feeding the spirit for you as well. Feed your spirit. Let that transformation come. Because as you feed your spirit, you are feeding your mind. And the transformation will only come when our minds are renewed. So thank you so much, woman of God, for this opportunity. Over to you, ma'am.